So if you're a designer and you'd like to create better logos, well, stick around because you're about to learn 7 advanced logo design techniques that many professionals use all the time. And in the next 10 minutes, you'll know how to use them as well. This video is also sponsored by Squarespace, which is an all-in-one platform to help you set up a site where you can showcase your work, sell products, or even sell your time. And we'll come back to them a bit later. But first up, we're gonna take a look at how colors can affect our perception of spacing within a logo. So here I have a logo design. We have a black on white, and then we have a white on black. And technically, both of these are exactly the same. However, the white logo on the black background actually makes the characters look closer together than they are, a little bit of optical trickery. So what we can do to make sure that both versions look the same is increase the tracking. And the tracking is the spacing between all of the characters, and we're just doing this very slightly. Okay, next up, one of the biggest logo design offenses that I see all the time, and this is selecting and pairing fonts. So here you can see a logo for a food delivery service, Macrolicious. However, we have a clean modern logo mark paired with a serif font for the brand name and a script font for the tagline. So let's duplicate this and see if we can get a bit more synergy between all of these different elements. So first, let's select the brand name, and we're going to try and find a font that matches the characteristics of the logo mark. So I want something clean and modern, but I also want some curves and something a little bit more playful. Now, we're not going to sit here and go through all of my fonts, but in terms of matching those characteristics, I came across Filson Soft. You can see it's clean and modern, comes with a variety of different weights, and it's got a few curves in the right places. So there we go, the logo mark and the logo type, they both hang together a bit better now. We could leave the tagline like this, and we could use an alternative font. However, something else we can also do is use the same typeface, but select a different font weight. Or what we could do is select the tagline, and then from the character panel, change this to all caps. So whilst you can pair different fonts together that adequately reflect the brand, using the same typeface but choosing different fonts and playing around with different font properties is also another way to go. Right, this next one is perfect if you're looking to find a good balance in terms of size between the logo mark, the company name, and perhaps the company's tagline. No more guesswork, because we're going to use the rule of thirds. So when designing a logo, you might randomly choose the size for the logo mark, the brand name, the tagline. And this is fine when you've got years of experience, but if you're new to logo design, how do you know how to size all this up? So as you can see, I've created a copy. And first of all, I'm going to select the line segment tool. And one technique we can use is called the rule of thirds. So I'm going to draw a line holding shift and give this a nice bright color and position this at the top of the brand name. Then I'm going to make a few more copies of this. So we'll go 1, 2, 3. And then I'm going to move the bottom one to the bottom of the brand name, and then just make sure all of them are selected. And whichever software you're using, just make sure you select the option that will distribute all of these lines an equal width apart. Now let's duplicate all 4 of these lines and drag them below. So essentially we've got the rule of thirds grid times 2, and we can now use these guides to size up that tagline. Now let's do the same with vertical guides. We'll line up 1 to the left side of the M, create a few duplicates, and then drag this one to the right of the S. And to do this, you should have 4 guides in total to create this rule of thirds grid, and then again, space them an equal distance apart. And now we can scale down that logo mark and make sure that it fits within the guides. Now let's add 1 more to this horizontal stack of guides. There we go. And I'm going to use this to determine how far above the brand name the logo mark should sit. Now let's select the magic wand tool and click on one of these guides to select them all, and then delete them. Now what we can do is get rid of the original that was sized completely at random. So let's pop this in the center and scale it up. And personally, I like to use this technique as a guide rather than a rule that's set in stone. So you can see me here just adding a pinch more spacing top and bottom. And there we go, much better. Now, before we move on to the next one, as I mentioned, this video is sponsored by Squarespace, a platform which is perfect for creatives, entrepreneurs, and business owners, because Squarespace has all the tools you'll need in one place. Plus, as well as setting up an absolute banger of a website, you can sell physical or digital products all through an online store where you can take payments through services like Apple Pay and PayPal. There's also plenty of website templates that are fully responsive, so you don't have to worry about whether or not it's gonna look good on mobile. And I think my favorite feature is Squarespace Blueprint and SEO Tools, and this is like a guided design system that enables you to create professional looking sites that are completely unique and built from the ground up, whilst also being optimized for SEO. So if you're interested, check out squarespace.com to get started with a free trial, and then when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/Dansky to save 10% off your first website or domain. Okay, back to the video. Now, this next one is incredibly useful, especially if you have a logo that incorporates a few odd angles and shapes, and this technique is all about optical alignment. So if you've joined the recent streams, this logo might look familiar, and we have a lovely iced coffee, but we have lots of curves and angles here that doesn't really line up with the text very well. So in this example, I'm going to rotate the iced coffee, so now the cup itself sits parallel to the text. This helps remove any unwanted negative space, and having this at an angle I think looks kind of cool. However, if I align both of these elements so they are vertically centered, this is how it looks, which is technically correct, but an easy way to check if this is off is to zoom out quite far, and this trick can help making identifying alignment issues a lot easier. And the main problem here is the Illustrator is aligning to the total height of the cup. Whereas in this example, I think it's best to align this using our eyeballs and align this optically so we're aligning to the main mass of the logo mark. That being the cup and the drink and not the little straw poking out the top. Next, we're going to look at something called clear space, and this is not only essential for logo design, but is something you'll definitely want to include if you're working on brand guidelines and you're defining how a logo should and should not be displayed. So here we have the Pronto logo, and one way to define clear space is to take one of the characters from the logo. So let's grab the O, and I'm going to put this on the right-hand side and reduce the opacity. And then what I'm going to do is duplicate this on the left side, the top, and the bottom. And this is a good alternative to using specific measurements because it can be scaled to any size. And as you can see, I've now added some guides, and you can select these, go to stroke, and then you can always turn on dashed line, and then mark out the area that is the clear space around the logo. And essentially that space should be respected so any text or images does not encroach within that space. Or if the logo sits within a website header, the nav bar should have enough spacing top and bottom. And this is to make sure that the logo doesn't get surrounded by loads of other design elements. Okay, so it's no good designing a logo and just hoping that it's gonna work everywhere that it's going to be used. Whether it's massive on a sign or super tiny on a mobile site, we've just gotta mock it up and see how it looks. And then we can make any changes where necessary. So here you can see I have a rather simple website template and I have a couple of different logos. And again, if you follow the streams, this was the first design, which may look familiar. However, as soon as you pop this in a website header, you can see it's rather small and very difficult to read pretty much anything. And this is why it's important to mock up your design in a variety of different places, including a website. So this is the new and improved design. Let's now pop this up there, scale it down. And already we can see our first problem. If I just move this up so the text sits more central, well, that big old iced coffee is crashing into the top of the navbar. So let's scale that down a bit. And I think actually making that a bit smaller helps the optical alignment issue even more. And now because I've brought the logo mark size down a pinch, I can actually now scale everything up, which makes the brand name easier to read. Now, I think this is fine. However, if I just zoom out, you can see I've got one that I prepared earlier. And this is exactly the same logo, but as you can see, I have a single line treatment rather than having the three words stacked. So when designing a logo, it's always a good idea to consider all of the different sizes and formats that are going to be used. And as you can see in this example, we've got the base of extreme horizontal format covered. And lastly, never send a logo off to a client or to a printer before cleaning up all of your handiwork. As you'll see, I can be quite messy getting to the final logo design, but it's fine as long as I clean everything up after. So this is the final logo mark for Luke's iced coffee. However, it's in black and white and everything is still fully editable. So as you can see, I have a lot of random pieces and everything looks fine until I throw in a colored background and you can immediately see the problem. So we need to clean this up. So let's select everything, go to Object and Expand. And doing this will also expand any strokes and turn them into fills. So there we go, you can see we have no stroke and we have a fill that is a question mark. And the question mark signifies that we have multiple colors selected. And let's just expand one more time to check we didn't miss anything. Okay, all looks good. Next, with everything selected, I'm going to grab the Shape Builder tool. And the first thing we need to do is hold down Alt or Option and drag through all of the white areas. Now we can also single click as well, and this will knock out that area. And the goal here, as I said, is to remove all of the white. So let's go and drag through. You might want to zoom in nice and close just so you don't miss anything. There we go. Let's drag through that and this bit. There we go. And I'd recommend doing this one piece at a time as well. And we're removing all of the white so that this logo design can work on a colored background or on top of an image, obviously without these random white pieces showing. Okay, let's just get that bit there and then very quickly remove the last few bits of white. And there we go. I think that's looking pretty good. I think there might just be a bit of white there. Yes, there is. Well done, Dan, you eagle-eyed ginger. Let's definitely get rid of that and remove it, and then zoom back out. Now, because we only have the black left, rather than use a shape builder tool to intricately combine everything, we can jump into outline mode with Command or Control Y, and then from the Pathfinder panel, select Unite, and this will combine all of the black shapes together. Then let's come out of outline mode, and you can see I've made a mistake. And if this does happen and something goes wrong, just undo a few times, and then I'm going to zoom in on those problem areas, and with the Shape Builder tool, just make sure that I have definitely knocked out all of those areas, and then we'll try uniting all of those shapes together again. There we go, that seemed to work. And the design itself shouldn't visually change, but all of those individual shapes have now been combined into a single shape. And it's not only best practice to clean up your logos like this once you've finished designing them, but it also reduces the chance that other designers, printers, or your client will have problems with the supplied design files. So hopefully you enjoyed today's video and learned something new. A big thank you to Squarespace for sponsoring this video, and of course to you for watching. I can't speak. Take care, and I'll see you in the next one.